Hey, Austin, what's up? Dude, I love what you've done at the game. Stayed humble, taking 35th so many times.
Yeah, really good at that.
You are an inspiration to me.
Appreciate that. There's a lot of people out there that need to fill that spot.
40 or 50 people go to the games. Like, and you can leave the game sucking. How is that? I mean, how is that possible? Isn't it crazy? Like the guy who takes last place at the Olympics sucks.
Right. The garbage. No one even knows who they are. You might as well be working at a grocery store.
And yet if they weren't there, the guy who took first place would have nothing. Mm-hmm. His first is only relative to all those people he beats.
Yeah, it's the...
But then there's people like Brooke Wells who take 14th place and they still get more accolades than someone who takes like fourth place, like, or fifth place, like Scott Panchik.
Yeah, that's, I mean, that's in any sport, in any, you know, it's any domain. It's the truth of what people want. I mean, just so look at social media. It's the unfortunate metric where, I mean, there are people out there that have couple hundred thousand followers, and who are these people?
You know, like, Brooke Wells deserves her followers. I didn't mean to say she doesn't.
Well, I mean, I don't know if deserves the right word, but earned. Yeah, I mean, there's consistent stream of media and back and forth. I mean, it's work. I mean, social media is exhausting. And if
it's
you
fun
have,
though, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, don't let it be exhausting. It's fun. I enjoy it. I never did social media until Instagram. Mm. I didn't do Facebook or Twitter. Mm. But Instagram is fun.
Yeah, it's once you have a voice, then you have to stay with that voice because that's why people follow you. It's like,
oh,
that's what's kind of like, it's like, because you realize like you'll post something outside the scope of your follower base.
I do that all the time.
And you'll get people, you'll get like 5 likes.
Oh, totally.
I have lots of those.
Yeah.
I had for a while I downloaded another app that like shows you your kind of Instagram stats, people joining and unjoining. I quickly deleted that. Anytime I post a picture of like...
Was it affecting your self-esteem and everything?
Not my self-esteem, but it was affecting what I posted and I didn't want that.
Mm. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I didn't want that.
Yeah.
And then Dave taught me the term thirst pick. Do you know that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What is that?
That's like I posted a picture of these guys downstairs a year ago flexing their lats or something. Mm. It was Rich and Austin was there and some other people were there.
That.
And I immediately got, thirst pick. Meaning just posting something that strictly to generate... has no value other than to generate likes and followers.
Right. It quenches someone's thirst for the, in our world, the half-naked human being.
Gotcha.
I have no issues with any of that.
It needs to be well-placed, but it should be in there about once a week.
Did you learn that from that app that he deleted?
Yeah.
Well, it is a little weird. I will say this. It's more than a little weird. And you know, there's... beautiful people that I have followed strictly because they're just so fun to look at. Mm. And yet they become one trick ponies and I unfollow them. Not out of like frustration or anger or anything. I had my fill.
Yep.
No matter how good something is, there's a limit. Like no one wants a hand job that lasts 24 minutes. Nice. They're amazing, but no one, there's a.
Yeah, we've passed that.
There's a cutoff point. Yeah, it's like your teeth start rotting and fall out. It's like too much.
Yes.
What are you doing here?
Oh, gosh, that's a good question.
And by the way, thank you. This is short notice, and we're stoked that you're here when I heard you were going to be here.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
I was like, wow, free podcast.
Yeah, heck yeah. No, myself and Mr. James Oliphant Hobart are going to be a...
Really? Oliphant?
That's his middle name, yeah.
Damn.
Yep. That's it. I thought it was Elephant for the longest time, but it's not.
There's a guy on Game of Thrones, and that's his... Not Game of Thrones. What's the cowboy one? HBO?
Hodor?
No. It's old. The guy, Al Swearengen, was on it. Mm. He was always saying, cocksucker. Deadwood. There was an Oliphant on Deadwood. Mm. Okay, sorry. Go on.
Oliphant. That's him. Yeah, we're out here for the old team series, live announcement. So we're going to have some fun. We're going to throw down. We actually still have to register. We need to do that today. But we decided to team up.
Does HQ cover your cost for that, or do you pay out of pocket?
I don't know. I mean, we were just going to sign up and see what happens.
Okay.
Figured if we perform well, hopefully it's covered by something.
Right.
Like just by pride of winning.
Dave doesn't tell you in advance? He's not like, hey guys, sign up and submit your blah 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 to invoice it to.
No,
he doesn't.
No,
it's like our camping trip.
Yeah,
he doesn't tell us where we're going, what route we're taking, what we're gonna eat, where we're gonna sleep, or what to bring, or any of that.
Yeah,
until we get there.
The blind trust. I think it's like, I think that's one of those things you need to have in order to just partake in this world. Just
okay.
Trust, show up, and do it, and whatever happens.
The guest is Austin Maliolo, infamous, notorious, famous, one of the smartest guys who works for CrossFit HQ. He is an L1 trainer. He is a flow master. If you don't know what that is, Tyson Oldroyd is here, senior producer here at CrossFit Inc., sitting in Matt Bischel's chair. He may actually replace Matt.
I was going to say, I don't know if this is Matt's chair anymore.
Matt does 5 shows and goes to Spain for 2 weeks. We have Eric Maciel, or Maciel, depending on the day, as the engineer. And why is Austin Maliolo here at CrossFit HQ?
Austin Maliolo is here for the team series announcement. And, you know, and we'll, it's always fun to come out and see a lot of the crew that we don't normally get to see, myself and James, on the road a lot. So, yeah, I get to do the live announcement for the team series, but also meet a lot of some new faces and see some faces that we haven't seen in a while.
So you're basically, you're the demo team for the team series, but it's more than the demo team because your score counts.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So, I mean, I have some demo team experience in the past. So we'll make sure we have proper movement and, you know, the reps count, but we are absolutely going to, you know, submit the score and try to just beat everyone.
And this starts Wednesday, September 20th.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. And so you'll be down in the HQ gym.
Mm-hmm.
They'll announce the workouts.
Yeah.
You will have they announced them yet, or you won't know them ahead of time?
We have no idea.
They haven't announced.
Okay. And then you and James will get at it live for the whole world to see.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think we're throwing down against two ladies.
And who's that?
We have Kelly Jackson and Jessica Griffith, right?
We need to get them on the show also.
Okay. Do we have women guests?
Have we had two?
Oh, we're afraid of them. Kelly Jackson, do you train with her? She's at Reebok CrossFit One?
She used to. She moved back home. Now she's just outside of St. Louis, so she's back at home. But we trained together for about a year and a half.
Has anyone ever wore a pair of non-Reebok shoes into the Reebok One gym?
Well, they have worn them, but they quickly remove them.
They do?
Yeah.
They walk
in with them and then leave with Reeboks.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, without a doubt.
What's the policy on that?
It's Reebok or bust. It's sort of like walking into the Patriots locker room with the New York Giants jersey on. It's not a good taste.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I see that. Have you worn a pair of the competing shoes to assess them?
I've done like the testing crew, like put them on and stuff, like with the engineers, the shoe engineers. But like, I've never like worn them beyond just the testing purposes.
And when you test them, like you did something in them, like you did Laredo or Fran or.
Yeah, more like just movements or like feel and stuff like that. Like, but they like cut shoes up and you can look at them and all that. It's amazing. They tell you more about a shoe than you could ever know.
What is your favorite shoe?
Gosh, every shoe that we've made I've worn and I've liked from the one to where we're at in the seven now. I mean, I really, the Nano 2, I think it was my favorite to wear, like with like traveling around. I think the best multi-purpose we had. I really like the 7 now. The 7 Weave, I think, is the proper protocol name. But I really like it, and I wear them all over, you know.
So. Do you and Hobart wear the same shoes?
No, his favorite shoe is like the Speed TR, I think.
That actually is a good looking shoe.
Yeah, really good looking shoe. He has really fat ankles, but we nicely call them sturdy.
Sturdy.
So he has sturdy ankles. And so like they make his foot look better. Like he has fat feet. You know, he struggles with
banana is pretty wide and chunky.
Yeah, so this shoe like it flatters his sturdiness. Yeah.
You're married, Austin?
I am, yeah.
And did you know Hobart before you knew your wife?
No. No.
So Hobart was around first?
No, my wife was around first.
Okay.
Yeah, my wife was, yeah. And then I met James.
Is there ever any conflict between your wife and James?
Well, there used to be, but now, but now that he has a girlfriend, I don't get to see James as much anymore.
Tell me about that conflict. Was it, I mean, because we have, we have Matt Bischel, head of social media.
Yeah.
And I haven't heard about anything like this in a couple of years. And then we have Jonathan Haynes, head of game social media.
Yeah.
And there was some conflict between Matt's wife and Haynes, basically like some competition for his time.
Bailey's going to love this. We're talking about this.
And there was some, some
tension.
Some tension.
Yeah. In the beginning, it's one of those where like, of course we're going to, do things like that. You know, we're going to do buddy cares and hang out and do sleepovers, that's just, we would take advantage of it. Like when we would travel for like seminars, we would ask the travel department like, hey, we'll just sleep in the same room. They'd always write back like, no, you guys are adults. You can have your own rooms,
You're like, no, but really.
Like, we'll just stay in the same bedroom. Right. We're fine,
Right.
So
one bed or two?
One bed. One king.
One king?
Yeah,
all right.
It's fine.
All right. I think I've seen the video.
Oh, yeah. I mean, if you can't sleep in the same bed as your best friend, there's a problem.
Right, I agree.
You have to be comfortable with that.
I just shared a tent with a guy, two-man tent.
Yeah.
I mean, it was really a one-man tent.
I was going to say that. That was not a two-man tent. Yeah.
I understand. But has she said to you like, hey, man, ease up on the James, or don't have James call past 10 o'clock at night? Or
it would
like,
be like, hey. Because we'll be like, oh, there it is. Yeah. We'll be like hanging out. She's like, please don't FaceTime him right now. We're hanging out.
Oh.
Yeah.
Like, so it's FaceTime letting him like really into like.
Into your world. Yeah.
Where is the most intimate place you've FaceTimed James?
Well.
Have you ever been? Because I know I've seen where you FaceTime him in bed.
Yeah.
Have you ever FaceTime in bed when Miss Maliolo's in?
Well, yeah. Like when we're in bed together. Yeah. I mean, there are some boundaries there. I mean,
Like as long as the sheets are like.
You turn the iPad to the wife.
Yeah.
Hi, James.
Yeah, we'll do that. Like, and he'll be in bed and with his girlfriend. And we'll like, hey, we've gone to the bathroom together. That that just sometimes just happens.
Yeah, totally.
You FaceTime, you pick it up, and you're just like, oh, here we are.
Wasn't there the video that Torin did with you guys where like first thing in the morning? Oh, that's
amazing.
Kev.
Yeah,
that was Kev.
Yeah, we did the hero.
I didn't see anyone else carry it like that though.
No, that was our.
No, that's
that
a
was,
different method.
That was our that? First easy. Thought. We're like, we got to carry this like an elephant walk, and it worked.
So you guys don't have any rules like. Pull the hole, hold the hole, pull the pole. No.
Yeah, we're equal opportunity.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah. Whatever's efficient.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I used to sword fight second, third grade in the bathroom all the time. Like everyone did it. Five dudes would be using one and it was just fighting streams, Ghostbuster style.
It's more efficient.
And now no one does that.
Yeah. Yeah, the
Well, not no one. You and Hobart.
Yeah, you and Hobart.
We try to keep it alive.
Yeah. You and Hobart cross streams. How did that start? Tell me your first meeting with James.
The first meeting was at 2010 regionals. Was it regionals? Yeah, regionals in Albany. He had loafers on, ninja pants, and sweatbands on his wrists. Yeah. And the sweatbands, not only were sweatbands, it was like they were like, they had like Mario mushrooms on. Like they were like, like Mario Kart, mushrooms on his wrists.
Like Mario?
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you beat him?
No. It was Rob Orlando, James, and then me. I came in third, but I beat him at the games that year.
Wow.
You guys were on staff at that point, right?
No, we were not. That was in 2000. So that was 2010. We got on staff at the end of that year.
Okay.
So he got on, like he was interning. He was like an intern ahead of me. So he's like always been like a month and a half ahead of me.
Gotcha.
Rob Orlando won a regional you were at?
Oh, yeah. 2010. That's when he clean and jerked 300 for a triple.
How?
Oh, that was sectionals. Look at me. My gosh.
Oh, that's awesome.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, there it is. You can also see Denise Thomas. She was an athlete at one point in her life.
Oh, check that out. That's awesome.
And Jen.
Is that Cariana?
That's Cariana, yeah.
Yeah.
How? Wow.
Oh, that's her gym.
How old is... But Rob Orlando is significantly older than you. He must be 40.
I think he's close to 40 now. Yeah.
He must. And how old are you?
30.
Wow.
Yeah.
Is that your anchor?
No, that's Tominski. Yep. That's Mike McKenna. Yeah.
Wow.
There it is. And that's it. That's what we got. We got a paleo kit.
Look at those two weirdos next to each other.
Yeah.
Who's the guy who, Mike McKenna? I don't know who that is. Did he ever go to the games?
No.
But you did.
I did.
How many times have you been?
I think six. Yeah. This year was the sixth.
I mean, as an individual.
Five. Yeah.
Do you remember when everyone thought Austin was a European?
Yeah, that was from this year.
That was it. Yeah, it was like,
yeah, because I went showed. What happened was, I was a young.
I want to say something about Cariano when this is all done. By the way, go ahead.
And so someone told me that, like, you know, compression will make you fitter. So I was like, okay, I will wear full compression head to toe.
I remember your compression phase. White. I totally remember that's like, your that's, compression
that,
phase.
There it is. That would be a.
Oh, but lose the shorts.
Yeah.
There's some great photos.
Oh, gosh.
Keep looking, Eric.
Oh, look at Hobart. Look, they're sweatbands. See that? That's when he wore sweatbands. Yeah. See that?
I feel like there were other athletes too. I feel like Kalipa had to be, he wasn't Peter allowed Edgen. To leave the house unless he was in compression for a while.
Yeah, like we were all like, compression was it, you know? So like, and then there
you
was.
You look great in it.
Thank you. And then white, because like, of course, they like, when I was like, oh, you get black around, I'm like, well, California's hot. Why would you wear black?
Right.
So I'll wear white. I didn't really think it through that I was going to look like a stormtrooper.
Yeah. A buff one.
Yeah.
Real buff.
Yeah, just jacked.
So that was my outfit. So then people thought I was European because only, you know, why would, you know, an American wear full head to toe compression?
True.
You know, so that was the start of the stormtrooper or the white knight.
Do you still compression?
No, I don't. I had an experience at regionals one year where I almost died. Not really, but it was just like, you know, I was head to toe compression, was 110 degrees out. And that did not help. It did not help the heat.
That was awesome. Yeah. I remember that. Oh, man. I hadn't met you yet.
It's like, who is this guy?
Oh, people will say, oh, that's a nice shot.
That's a great shot.
People will say stuff along the lines, and I'm sure you've heard it growing up, like you'll be hanging out with a bunch of friends and some girl who you find attractive or you thought was attractive will be like, I would never date a guy that's blah, blah, blah. And like, she describes you to the T. Mm. And I'm sure the one that you've heard before is, oh my God, that guy's so short. He's so cute, but so short. I would never date him. And he's like 5'7". And
yeah.
You're like, do you ever get that? And you're just like,
come on.
Yeah. Like you're not hurt, but you're also just like, what the fuck?
Yeah, have some awareness that I'm 5'5". Yeah.
Like, have you heard that?
Oh yeah. Well, I get to me like I'll get it to like even more like man, they'll people look at me and be like, you're a lot smaller in person.
Just straight up.
Straight up, I'm like, oh, yeah, you know, like man, I thought you were bigger.
Are you taking a dig at me? Is this?
Oh yeah,
a people
like,
yeah.
Oh yeah, like man, I thought you were like gonna look bigger. I was like, nope, this is what you got. Yeah, 5'5", 175, just pure
man,
small man.
How tall is Hobart?
He's like 5'8". He's a good looking man.
He looks like he was the same size as you just now when you were in here.
I know, he's losing some
weight.
You
make him look small.
Yeah, he gets stressed out about it.
Oh, I didn't mean like that. I meant shorter.
He's 5'8". I just try to like walk on my toes.
Allison NYC, I haven't talked to her, seen her in years. She had a kid. Congratulations. I remember one time in 2009 or something, she said something like, oh my God, that guy could be attractive, but he has shit brown eyes. I'd never date a guy with shit brown eyes. And I was just like, you know, that was another one. I'm just like, As my wife would say now when I repeat stories like that, she goes, oh, that stuck, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, Van Morrison stuck. Would disagree with your, you know, talking about brown eyes like that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's you and Hobart?
That's it. That's at regionals. That's when he beat me. But that's right after the event that we did.
That's right after he beat you. And it's amazing because that's not stage. That's just... Just bros.
Yeah. That's right after we did a handstand walk and he fell on his face trying to, so that was like where we had like one event right after another and he literally went full failure and face planted and he had a black eye for the rest of the weekend. It looked like someone punched him in the face.
He beat you and he had a black eye.
I beat him in the handstand walk. He beat me in the snatch event, which subsequently is what
put him over.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And he's consoling you.
There's a video. We have a video shot.
That's a lot of skin. You know, there's a lot of your or his armpit sweat getting on you right there.
Well, that's my position since I'm under everyone. I've just succumbed to the fact that everyone's armpit is going to be on my shoulder
right there.
Yeah.
Someone described today in the hallway to me somehow the term Reaganomics got brought up and trickle down economy, and we were talking about it and someone walks by and goes, yeah, that's when the rich are pissing on the poor. I was like, wow, that's a, I haven't heard that.
That was a Cliff Notes version.
Is there a, there's the L1 team, mm-hmm. an amazing team.
Yes.
Tell me how amazing they are.
It's probably not a more impressive group of people that you could ever establish, in my opinion. Yeah.
And why is that?
Well, one, they're all over the world. So it's rare to have a team that is so congruent in their views and their delivery that's all over the world. And two, I can go work with anyone on the team and never have worked with them anywhere ever and deliver an excellent product, which is unbelievable. And working for a lot of teams and working with different people, that's almost never seen. But I think that's the most impressive thing is the alignment on what the goals are and how to execute, and the preparation before you actually execute on the task is so paramount that when you're with each other, it's easy and you just highlight each other. And that's a testament to people. And it's, I think that's what makes it so special.
What is the message you guys are delivering in that 2-day course, in that Saturday, Sunday? By the way, that's an amazing group of people right there.
Gosh, that's an old one.
That's a stacked group. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're all like that though. That's kind of what you're saying.
Yeah.
Like every week, every Monday, you see these photos kind of trickle around social media.
Yeah. Look at Julie Fouché.
Yeah.
Heather Bergeron's pregnant.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you just take a look at that. I mean, think, and the question you said, like, what's being delivered across 2 days? And I think, yeah, we could talk about course content and all that stuff. I mean, but ironically enough, all of that is out there, right? Like, I mean, you could pull up the manual and read it. So the content is there, and from the videos that we've released from, you know, it's the content is not what's being delivered. I think if there's one thing, it's inspiration across 2 days to teach people how to educate, inspire, and entertain, right? And I think that's what's being delivered across. And when on the week after a seminar, we get feedback from participants. That's the biggest thing that you hear is that it was, you know, saying thank you for the inspiration and or the reinvigoration to go and make positive impact on other people's lives or start their journey to do that. That's what's being delivered across 2 days. Where, yeah, we're teaching about variance, functionality, intensity. We're teaching about meats and vegetables, nuts and seeds, some fruit, little starch, and no sugar. We're teaching people to keep their intake to support exercise and not body fat. We're doing all of that. We're teaching people how to move well. But the vehicle in which that's delivered, that's the product that's being delivered.
When I've heard Greg talk about how teaching your kid how to swim or to float at a very young age is inoculating them against drowning.
Right.
And I really like the way, you know, he's a poet, just the way he says that. And then I'm not going to do this next statement justice that he was saying, but then he basically went in to say, and what the L1 is it's the software to the human hardware. It's the most optimal software you could run in this human hardware. And from there, we were talking about how all parents should take that, and that basically it's an inoculation in our current state. It becomes super relevant. It's inoculation against misinformation. Mm. There's so much misinformation out there, right?
Yeah.
And yet, all you have to do, and I know this is self-serving, but all you have to do is go to an L1,
yeah,
or go to CrossFit.com and look at all the journal stuff, and it's there, right?
Yeah.
Do you view it like that? Like every weekend when you're given this, you're like, oh my God, I'm like,
yeah, it's,
you now have it. Now you can go home and tell your parents, hey, you shouldn't be eating that shit. Hey, this is how you squat. Hey, this is how you should lift a box up on top of the refrigerator. Hey kids. Like,
I think what I've seen in the past, 7-8 years of doing this is it's changing. Is that when I first started working on staff, that's exactly what it was like. Now, I think what's more important is something you said is the misinformation. People are sponges for information, and they're coming into seminars with a good amount of knowledge, right or wrong, skewed or unskewed. They know what's coming. And I think that what we do across 2 days is really clarify what our prescription is and how elegant and how simple it is and how to execute that and the importance of that. Because we'll have a seminar of 50 people and 48 of them will have been doing CrossFit for 6 6 months to a year plus.
Yeah.
And so they know a good amount of it. And but the problem is that, I don't know if it's necessarily a problem, but as CrossFit has grown, as has grown other information, you know, or the ante, whatever that is, right? Which is still strange to me, but it, and that happens, right? So I think that's a really big thing, is just clarifying that. And the questions you get are, now that we're getting, is just, you know, I've heard this, or, you know, my favorite one now, right? Because that awful documentary showed up on Netflix about vegetarianism, is not like, you know, meat will kill you or something. You know, it's like, you know, what are your thoughts on, you know, not eating meat? You know, you guys advocate eating, you know, meats and vegetables, blah, blah, blah. And they're like, and it seems like there's a movement to not eat meat. You know, it's like, all right, well, let's, now we can have a discussion. And whereas before it was just like, tell me what to eat, you know, or tell me how much to eat. But now people are coming in with sort of these other notions, and because there's a lot more information out there.
How many L1 trainers are there?
Level one trainers, I think the staff's right around between 150 and 200. I'd probably right around there, an average of that.
Is there a Blue Angels team?
Is there a Blue Angels team?
You know what I mean? Like, yeah. Is there like, oh shit, here they come?
I still think that's like Dave Castro and Nicole Carroll. Like the Blue Angels team is, in my opinion, it's like when they are at a seminar, it's like, okay. I mean, and then obviously, you know, if coach shows up, then it's, you know, all bets are off.
The Gold Angels.
That's
always,
right.
It's always impressive though when you get the trainer email, it's like, oh man, there's four Flowmasters on this gig. Like, you guys are all like, I mean, that's a stack.
Like, would you seminar and Adrian ever be at the same? Or you and Chuck? Or you and Todd? Do you guys ever like?
It's rare, you know, to have like Tyson said, like a handful of Flowmasters. I mean, Level twos is probably where you see more of that possibility, because it's you know, traditionally a little more veteran staff. But yeah, if you see a trainer email come through and there's a couple Flowmasters on there, it's you know, it's, and I think sometimes, like, you know it as a fellow staff, but you know, the participants don't know, you know, but you know that they're going to have a pretty unique experience because of the experience, you know, where when you listen to veteran staff that have been around and have, you know, gone through the ringer, and just the stories and the relatability that they can give to the participants is unparalleled.
So there isn't a Blue Angel official Blue Angels team.
I don't think so. I mean,
I'm going to propose that to Dave and Nicole, the Blue Angels.
Yeah. We, you know, James and I always joked that we wanted like
varsity jackets
with like the awesome letters on it. Like, we always wanted that, like
with stripes.
Yeah. With stripes on it, like earn your stripes, like Grease, you know, walk around with the, you know, the guys get one color, the girls get another color. It never came through.
Married, mm-hmm. L1 staff, yep. Full-time job.
Yeah.
At Reebok.
Yeah.
At the Reebok gym.
Yep. The Reebok World Headquarters area.
Is it too much? Is it too much?
So is it too much? Describe it.
So, I don't know if this is true. I just read this, but I heard like Einstein did three things. He was into the sciences, mm-hmm. whatever he did there. He was into sailing and playing the violin. Mm. I also hear he was into womanizing, but let's just say those three. And he really stayed focused on those three. He didn't stray from those so that he could be great at all those.
Right.
And you have, you know, you have two things on your, you have three things, four things on your plate that are pretty crazy. Relationships are crazy.
Yeah.
A full-time jobs are crazy, but being a games athlete is sort of like a different, is like real kind of crazy. And then the travel that comes with being on the L1 team is, you know, it's good for a couple of years, and then, you know, you become an old man like you and that shit will start wearing on you.
Yeah. You get gray in your beard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So by, is it too much? Are things suffering because you're juggling four major balls?
Yeah.
And I wouldn't ask a normal person this, but I know you like to do things obviously to perfection.
Yeah. No, I think, are things struggling? Of course. Right. I mean, it's like you have a bandwidth. I think that, one, I'm very fortunate and lucky to have a wife that accepts that I work 7 days a week and travel every weekend. You know, without a doubt, I mean, the first thing people say is that you're, your wife is the only person that could have would ever deal with you. And I would agree. So like, you know, it's like, and so I think that's one thing. And I think as another piece that I've learned is surround yourself with people that are better than you. Whereas if you have a team, you know, and you create a team of people that are around you that can, you know, challenge you and force you to be better, but also, you know, push the entire entity to be better, that's the goal. The challenge with that is that they will inevitably leave you if you can't keep them to stimulate them. But I think that's something I've learned, you know, with, you know, running the gym at Reebok, or, you know, having a CrossFit gym outside of that, or, you know, things like that. I think it's having good people around you to always push and challenge you. But I love the challenge of new challenges and creation. You know, I think something that when I grew up, I used to work construction, and I didn't realize it during it, but one thing I missed.
How old were you when you did that?
I was like 16.
Mm-hmm.
And just like at the end of a day.
Did you ever
bury
a body at the construction site?
No, I was never asked to do that, but okay. I definitely made every mistake on a job site you could.
Okay.
But not that.
Okay.
We
should get into your past a little bit after this.
Whew. Okay. You know, you'd start the day and you finish the day and you'd actually see something change. Like you did that, whether you dug a hole, whether you built something, that, and you did it. That's something that is so special. And that's what I really like, that's why I love cleaning a gym. So I love the basic things of, hey, let's walk around the gym and let's clean it, because it starts dirty and it finishes clean. And you did that and can see marked change. And I like to pull that big picture of whether it's creation of, whether it is a small business or whether it is a team or a new challenge within the team. So that's something that I really enjoy. But to answer your question specifically, is it difficult? Yes. Does something suffer? Without a doubt. Would I do it any other way? Probably not. And maybe my ignorance blinds me with that. But when kids come down the line, which my wife wants, I'm sure, you know, in order for me to be the person and father that I would want to be, something else will have to suffer, because you have to make a commitment when it comes to that. So the awareness of that is probably higher than it's ever been because of the impending, you know, potential addition to our family. So
was getting married fun?
Yeah. Getting married is great. I mean, I was dating my wife, Maren, for 7 years, and then we got married, and, you know, so it was like, it was great.
Does anything change when you get married?
Nothing. No, not one thing.
Just fluff. One day you wake up and you're married.
And you're like, wow, that was.
Did she take your name?
She did. Yeah. Maren Maliolo.
She didn't do any hyphenated, nothing.
No, No, she's a boss. She was like, no, we'll take that last name. We're moving on.
That's cool.
Yeah.
What's the most important thing an affiliate owner can know from your perspective? What was the most important thing? What was your mantra?
A quote I heard from Coach Glassman was, make sure your bathrooms are always clean and make sure your people air squat with beauty, and never lose sight of that. And I think about that every single day. First thing I do when I walk into any gym is I go to the bathroom. People probably think I have a urinary tract infection, but the truth is I just want to go clean, you know, see what goes on there.
Have you used our bathrooms here at HQ?
I have numerous times, yeah.
Have you seen those plastic things on the ground that we have? They're kind of new, right?
Yeah, they're only in the bathrooms up here.
Okay, yeah.
Have you seen those?
No.
Oh, they're these pieces of plastic, and they wrap around the bottom of the toilet.
Yeah.
And you put your feet up on them, and they, there's one.
Squatty
potty.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm aware of them.
Have you ever used one?
Yes.
Okay. So.
And the benefits of for the colon.
Is it benefits for the colon?
Very much so.
That's the point.
Yeah. Oh, right? I thought the whole point was that, like, you don't have to wipe. Like, it just makes it a cleaner.
No, I definitely, I don't. I don't.
That explains some stuff. Yeah.
Maybe not have to wipe.
Okay.
But it makes it so that you don't have to wipe as vigorously.
Yeah.
There we go. There's the colon.
Yeah. There's the.
I had no idea that there was anything like.
Yeah.
I thought it was just so it doesn't smear against your ass cheeks.
Which that may be like a secondary or tertiary benefit, but the primary benefit is the position it puts your body in.
I was in India for a month.
Yeah.
And just shitting in holes.
Oh, yeah.
And it just really helped the wiping situation. Now, look at. if that's really an ad for the Squatty Potty, that's fucking bullshit. No one wants their skin touching that part of the toilet. See how her,
barefoot?
Yeah, that's just ridiculous.
Well, it's a non-traditional way to sit on the toilet, I would assume, as well.
But you just move the Squatty Potty out a little bit. You don't want, I mean, that thing is just covered in urine. Whether you see it or not, that's not a clean, that's not.
She's working on her ankle flexibility. That's what she's working on there.
I mean, maybe if it was your own personal bathroom at your house.
Yeah. But yeah, she's got a lot of skin on porcelain.
Anyway, I've been figuring the one out here more and more. You have to be very careful because if you have, let's say she had her pants lowered, her pants would then be cleaning around the edge of the bowl.
That's what we've been, this has come up a little bit. And basically the argument is, hey, this thing sucks. Because
if you don't know how to use it right,
it's got to be covered in urine.
That too.
Yeah. And then if you choose not to use it,
you have to touch it.
Then your pants and your short, whatever, is just cleaning.
There's a way to do it. There's like steps you have to go through. I'm starting to figure it out so that you can get on it. Your pants don't hug the bowl.
Yeah, like step one, just kick it to the other side of the room.
No, I like using it. I like using it.
What if you take your pants completely off? Because that mitigates.
I do take my vest off when I shit.
Well, that's good, but I don't know if that helps the Squatty Potty scenario.
I do. And we have nowhere to hang it, so I have to search around on the floor like to make sure that there's a spot that I'm comfortable setting it.
So it's super important for your bathrooms to be clean here, based off all of this.
It is.
Because you're taking your clothes off. There's things you got to move around.
Not your clothes off, your jacket. We have showers too, and the showers don't have toilets, and that kind of bugs me because then you know just people are pissing in the shower. But
yes, there's a lot of protocol there.
It was more fun talking about the Blue Angels. When I first met you, I think it was 2010, and there was a Tahoe showdown.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And it was there were two teams, a rogue team versus
Again Faster,
another team. Yep.
Yeah.
And which team are you on?
I was on Again Faster that time, along with
that's Austin.
That's me. That's actually in James Hobart's driveway, by the way.
Wow.
Yep.
You look bigger in photos than you do in person.
Thank you. Adds 10 pounds. I need that 10 pounds. Look at James. Just coach me up with the sweatband on again.
And so that you're 30 now. That was 8 years ago. Mm-hmm. You were 22. And I remember my wife at the time had made a video that featured you. Mm. And there was, you had had a surly past. Is that the right word?
Yeah. I'm not sure of the definition of surly, but it sounds like it would fit my past.
Me neither. Yeah. How about squirrely past?
That would probably fit too.
Exciting. Where were you born?
I was born in New York. I think a little town called Mayapack, New York. Yeah. So, I mean, that's where I grew up, around that area, like upstate New York, about 2 hours north of New York City.
Mom, dad, divorced together?
Well, yeah. So they got divorced when I was 8 years old. So
mine got divorced when I was 3. 8 sounds rough.
Yeah. And you're aware enough for it to affect you. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, 8 years old, and then at the time, yeah, that was like, so if you were to like pull back and look at the root cause of a lot of the, surliness, you can pinpoint it back to that, but then obviously bigger issues beyond that.
So you stay in that town until you're how old? What was the name of it?
So that's where I was born, but what I grew up around was like LaGrangeville, New York, just outside of Poughkeepsie, New York for reference.
Okay. I have no idea. No. I know New York City.
Yeah. It's 2 hours north of that.
Okay.
An hour and a half south of Albany.
Okay. So. And you were there, you did high school there?
Well, I went to 4 different high schools.
Oh.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. So.
You get kicked out of, just get in trouble and.
Well, which one?
That's a tough time of life to be moving around.
Yeah. So it was all, I went to like a pre-prep school. In Connecticut, right? Thai and all that sort of stuff. That was 9th grade. So that would like, you could go to 9th grade.
Did you sleep there?
No, I was a day student. But then I went to a prep school in Massachusetts called Williston Northampton School. I actually repeated my freshman year, which is somewhat common in boarding school. And that's where I, played hockey, football and lacrosse, you know, and it's so common in sports. So you get another 4 years of sport.
Yeah.
And that's like, you know, that was sort of like at the catalyst of when things started to just go downhill.
Sophomore year.
Yep. Yeah. Sophomore year. And then I left that prep school because I just...
And is that because... What caused that? You were just a bad kid in the prep school, just like throwing smoke bombs into classrooms? I wasn't or stealing cars or like...
It was more prior to like that. That it got there. It got to being, you know, bad. But before it was like I was able to convince my parents that I wanted to go to a public school because the restrictiveness of a private school, right? When you know, and...
And were you always a good speaker, like eloquent and like you had your, like now your shit's tight. Were you tight with your parents? Like it was easy to...
I was a very good manipulator.
Okay.
Yeah. And you learn that in a part of a divorced family, you learn how to play both sides.
Right.
Right.
So it's a skill set, unfortunately, that is easy to practice when you have two households that don't like each other.
Okay.
So with that skill set, was able to convince my parents to pull me out of that school, which was, you know, you can pinpoint a lot of very poor decisions. That was one of many. Went to public school. Now this was just around like Poughkeepsie area, Arlington High School. So going from a very small prep school to a massive public school. And that's sort of when
So that's your third high school starting your junior year or sophomore year?
Well, yeah, it was technically, yeah, sophomore, junior, because it was unique because I had that repeat. So
right. It
was sort of like, yes,
okay,
to both. And that's when, I was hanging out with a crowd that was like, you know, 3 years older than me. And that's a significant age range at that time because, you know, you're 17 and they're, some of them are 20, 21.
Right.
Super impressionable.
Yeah. Oh yeah. And all you're trying to do and all I was trying to do was, get their approval, their recognition. So ended up getting, that was when I ended up getting arrested, and that's when I went, I got
shot. For what?
So I just attacked a vehicle because I thought they were, attacking our group of friends, right?
Physically.
Yeah. Yeah. So that wasn't good. If you were to say, where's the one, like,
were the cops there and they saw you do it or someone turned you in?
No, they called the cops and yeah, because we were just, drunk at a party
and they just showed up at the scene of the crime.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So
that's unfortunate.
Yes. So, and then from there got shipped away to, what they would call like an outdoor reform place in Utah.
Oh, where you would spend the night shit.
For 2 months.
Did you attack with a weapon?
Yes.
Oh, shit.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, it was either go and get shipped away out there to it's called Second Nature. It's in Duchesne.
I'm from Utah.
Yeah.
I'm familiar with this place.
Yes.
I have friends.
Let me ask you this real quick. Yeah. What's going on in your other parts of your life then? Are you playing any sports at school?
I was good enough to, not go to class, but, forge the notes and get by because it was just very different. I was still playing hockey and playing football, but it was sort of going towards the climb where like, I think I skipped like the football camp, optional football camp in the summer. And so this was at the end of...
But you still had structure. I mean...
Yeah.
In your life.
Yeah. So
you were getting passing grades.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. You were forging notes, but you were still,
Yeah. There was,
sounds like you were doing more than I was doing in high school.
Yeah. But except taking the certain things to the extreme, you know, and that's ended up, tell you, it's either you're going, and this is where, for me, the big thing was like where my dad was like, hey, because it was me probably going to go to jail or, he fought for me to go to this, this program. And that was essentially the deal, which... At the time, I had no idea. So, you get picked up at 2 a.m. by 2 goons.
Oh, shit.
They zip tie your hands and...
That's awesome. That's how you got taken away.
Yeah. So like, they wake you up in the middle of the night, they zip tie your hands, they, hand in the belt loop.
That's not traumatic.
They're huge, and they're massive human beings. And then, they escort you all the way out to Utah from New York.
And is your dad standing there crying at the door?
Well... he was actually there, and that was like, if there's a moment burden to your mind, it's that,
right?
But
because your dad should fucking put a cap in those guys and save you.
Yeah, except it's like you're like, yeah, so the
he set you up
the
for
emotional
it.
Turmoil, all of that, you
he
know.
Commissioned it.
That's it.
Ooh, yeah,
yeah, literally,
oh, man.
And then you shipped out to Utah for, I was out there for 2 months, where And then, I mean, you're fully, and this was like at the end of the summer, beginning of the school year, would have been my senior year mm-hmm. of school at that point where I was. So,
which that, you were looking forward to.
Well, who doesn't look forward right. to, like, you know,
right.
final year.
That's yeah. it, the final year of all the good stuff that goes along with it. You know, it that story is just crazy. Just, you know, you hike 11, 20 miles a day. I mean, I was a run wrist for 2 weeks, so I wasn't allowed to have shoes. So like for certain
points.
Oh, that's
killer.
So, you know, like.
That's awesome. So oh, you yeah. did all the hikes and shit barefoot?
Well, they'd let you have for the hikes, but like if we were at base camp, you had to walk out no shoes. So your feet would be bleeding and stuff.
Anyway. And so everyone knows that you're a flight risk and yeah. you're the new guy?
You'd sleep over. So you'd have a counselor that would put a tarp over your sleeping bag. They would sleep on the tarp. So any move you'd make, they hear you if you were trying to escape it.
What night. If you have to take a piss?
You have to wake them up,
wake
and,
them
they
up
escort
and they
you,
escort
yeah?
you. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's that. And then from there, after 2 months.
Did you like that? Was that a good experience? Or were you just making friends with other criminals?
There was a lot of other criminals there. Yeah.
yeah.
It really opened my eyes to, and that was the start of it. Cause you know, then from the next step, it was even more, but it was crazy. The stories, I mean, I would see drug addicts that were my age that would come out and come off meth or heroin and they put them on a tarp and they'd be there for 36 hours. It was like, it was just crazy. I'd never seen anything like that before. You know, so you like, oh,
was it profound while you were there? Or is it something that you've come to realize, wow, that was a real pivotal moment in my life?
There was a lot of moments that were profound, but again, later making more mistakes later on in life, you know, there was a few more key moments that happened in my life in order for it to truly stick. Gotcha. But if you were to say what was one of the most pivotal points in my life, it was those 2 months out there, knowing I wasn't going to go back home, having no communication, knowing that no one of your friends even wrote you to where you were, like things like that. You're like, okay.
And seeing who your peers were, the other people who were there for yeah. similar reasons.
So there's a lot of things that would, you know, really hit home at that. And then from there, you know, I got sent down to Virginia for 2 years to what is considered a therapeutic boarding school.
So now you're like 19.
Yeah. Well, yeah, yeah, yeah. So I've graduated late from
okay.
high school.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what was that like, the therapeutic boarding school?
You know,
did you have to go there? Was that still part of the deal?
Well, I mean, have to is a strong word, but it was highly recommended after this, you know, the second nature is that you go to a school like that. And then there's a whole range of them from very, very restrictive to a little less restrictive. And then you have to take all these tests. Like, are you crazy? You know, like I took a 500 question test.
And it's all dudes?
So the second nature was all dudes. And then when I went down to Carlbrook, that was co-ed down there.
And how many people there?
120. Hmm. Yeah, max. Yeah.
And how were those 2 years?
So that was
still no CrossFit.
Yeah. So I was still working out. Like I would like, even like when I was out in second nature, like I would do push-ups and stuff, like, you know, in the desert and stuff like that. Like I always worked out and I enjoyed it. It was
why did you work out? Who got you into that? Your dad, your mom, football?
Yeah. My dad did 70 push-ups once and I saw him. I couldn't even do 2. I was like, okay, I need to do something. And he told me,
how old were you when that happened?
I was like, you know, 15 or
something. That's bad.
And he goes to me, he goes, you're never going to be the strongest. You're going to be, someone's always gonna be better than you. You got to be the hardest worker. And the only way you can do that is to work out. If you want to make the varsity team, you got to work harder than everyone. So
how, when you saw your dad do those 70 push-ups, what was his build like? Is he 5'5", 135 doing that, or
he's 5'10", you know, like 175. He's always been athletic and fit. I mean, he does CrossFit now, like, you know, every day, and you know, he can do all sorts of stuff.
That's cool.
But you know, he was doing dips and all that sort of stuff, and I was like, I couldn't do anything. I was just some little, you know, soft kid. So he inspired me a lot to you know, be the kid that would have to work out to play sports and to be well, you know, to do well in those sports. So that always stuck with me, you know. And when I was down in Virginia at Carlbrook, you know, I started the workout club and things like that. You know, it's like, we got to get this gym up more than once a week.
So you were exhibiting signs of leadership already. And if you would have stayed in New York, you'd have been the head of your gang.
Probably. Yeah. I mean,
at some point, you would have sat at the head of the table.
I would have been dead probably for sure.
You know? Really?
But yeah.
It was going that way.
Yeah. Yeah. It was going that way. It was just, I mean, just because you're so blinded by influence. And when you're at that age, you know, it's just like, there's, there's no one. It's like, it's either you're in or you're out. And like anyone that has some sort of a scope of practice, they leave, right. You know, and I got, you know, when I got shipped away, it's, and what's amazing now is like, I have very little, zero contact with any of those people from that part of life, but like, you'll kind of catch wind and, you know, it's like, okay, it's what you would expect where they would be. Or, you know, and after even leaving Carlbrook, I mean, these were some of these kids were really struggling. And since
that's the place in Utah,
Virginia.
Oh, Virginia. Okay.
You know, they, you know, I mean, I know five or six people that are no longer with us because they just, even after graduating and all that, like couldn't take it, you know, struggling that much. And like, that's the caliber.
You mean
of
2 years of that reform school, they go back home and they get back into their fucked up lifestyle and they're OD, get shot.
Yep.
Blah, blah, blah. Okay. Yeah. Commit suicide.
Yep. All the above. So, you know, so that's, and then.
So that, you leave there, you're there for 2 years.
Yeah, about a year and a half, yeah.
And you're, what's life like there? You're just lights out every night at 10 o'clock.
Very
regimented. It's just 2 years of just.
Very regimented. I mean, you're going to school, you know, but I mean, the biggest thing was like.
I mean, do you get to, when do you kiss your first girl?
Well, I mean, prior to that, you know, like, I mean, a lot of life was lived before.
But 17. All that gets shut down, right? All that fun stuff, dating, kissing girls, calling people.
Yeah. All that. Yes. It's gone.
So it stopped his sophomore year.
Yeah.
Basically.
Oh, yeah. Man. Junior year.
Junior.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you have any tattoos or piercings at that point?
Well, I had, you know, I had lip ring, earrings, 7 different hair colors.
No shit.
Yeah.
You look like Adrian Bosman.
Yeah. Yeah. He made it look way better. I didn't look that good. He worked it. Yeah. You know, punk rock and all that stuff. So
2 years at that school, and then what's it like when you come out of there? Is it literally like you're back into the world, like you see like in the doors open to the jail and Austin walks out?
Go to college, which is crazy, right? So I
crazy. College is crazy.
So graduate in December, so in an awkward time. Start school in a spring semester in upstate New York.
How old are you?
18.
Okay.
Yeah. And then you go right into school. And of course, you know, you go, you know, and you sort of, you pull back on the college experience. And this was like, if you were to say like, all right, the first year was, it was one of those straight and narrow. Like you gotta, it was as
straight out of reform. Like right. You're good.
And then of course it deteriorates.
So you go to all your 8 o'clock classes, doing your homework.
So you have 4.0 GPA, all that good stuff.
Bed.
That's it. You know, so you can bounce the quarter off the bed sheet, all that good stuff that you learned down in Virginia, you know, spacing out your hangers. So that's the same space, all that. And then, you know, and then from there, it was junior year, this junior year thing.
Yeah.
I ended up, you know, I was in a fraternity that was not good, you know, then running the fraternity.
So more leadership skills?
Yeah, yeah.
Couldn't avoid it,
yeah. I guess kept falling into the wrong bucket.
Yeah.
You know, wrong place, wrong time. There was a big fight and ended up, there was a lot of, you know, of course, everyone that was there was like from out of town and stuff. Someone saw me, recognized me. I got pinned for being there, get kicked out of college.
For beating someone up?
Well, I just was there. So, and it was a lot of powerful points in that for me. One, it was junior year, or no, was it senior year?
And tying this to like what you were saying now, one of your sort of cornerstones of your philosophy is life is to surround yourself with people better than you. You weren't doing that yet.
Right.
And you hadn't picked that up yet. You were kind of the best person in your group instead of the.
And not only that, it was the big thing that when you end up getting kicked out of school for something that, you know, you didn't do, but it doesn't matter, right? You're there. And again, everything that mattered in that moment, it was from the embarrassment of having to tell my family.
Yeah.
I was dating my girlfriend, now wife at the time. I mean, it was just.
Oh, she's seen it all.
Oh man, everything.
What a good woman.
And the best. And.
She must be so proud of you.
Yeah. Yeah. She's unbelievable. The fact that she even just, you know, sticks with me through all my idiocracy, but you know, it's. Going through all of that and then realizing that like my, and for me, it was like my dad that I was like, man, like when he's sticking by me, like I've done everything in my power to like essentially say, I'm
not deserving.
Right. I'm an awful human being, yeah. you know, and then realizing that there was this moment that every decision that I made was my fault. Whether I choose to be around people, who's around me, every single decision is my fault. Everything that happens in my life is my fault. No one else's.
And taking responsibility, the world could use more people like that.
And because I had to come to the facts that this was my fault. I got kicked out of school and that was my fault. Everything was my fault. And I had to take responsibility of that, ownership of that. And that's when it all came together. That's when everything sort of hit me. And because it was hard. I mean, I didn't want.
That's an amazing turning point. Sorry to interrupt, but people will go their whole life blaming their parents, blaming their parents, blaming their parents, blaming everyone around them. But there becomes a point in your life, I don't know how old it is, but no matter what anyone has ever done to you in the past, it all shifts and now it's all your fault.
Yeah.
Even what someone did to you if it was their fault when you were 16, when you're 24, it's no longer their fault.
Yeah.
Perspective changes entirely.
Yes, if you're mature.
Sure.
Yeah.
But it does happen.
At some point, you have to own everything.
Yeah.
Everything. You're driving down the street, a car hits you, not your fault at all. No. It's yours.
Yeah.
It's your life. Take fucking responsibility. Sorry. Yeah. It's killer that you had that turn. That's a pretty young age to take that turning point.
Yeah, it was, and I point it back.
It's rock bottom, kind of, right?
It was, and I always point back to because oftentimes I'll ask how did that, I had someone in my life that cared about me enough, cared about me more than I cared about myself, mm-hmm. that believed in me more than
this
I believed
in
myself, my dad. And that's something that when you let yourself feel that, it's awful. I just remember I was sitting in my room for 2 days just crying, embarrassed, I was embarrassed to go, this was in October.
In your bedroom at the fraternity or you're already gone?
At home now, I'm already home, gone. Yep. I got to see family for Thanksgiving. Just what am I going to tell them? I wanted to lie to them. All of these things going through my mind of the embarrassment.
Right.
And from there to
avoiding discomfort.
That's it. And then finally realizing that, this is my fault. I have to take ownership. I have to actually have these conversations. I have to look my father in my eye and apologize for another, yet another mistake, at this point, another costly mistake.
It starts to feel insincere, right? I've been in that position where I'm telling someone sorry for the 100th time and you're like, fuck, do they even believe me?
Yeah. And it's that moment where I knew they didn't. And the only way I could earn trust was through action and consistency, and that's where everything changed. I mean, that's literally where my entire life changed, where I was. So I was working construction. I was going to.
You come home and do the right thing. You cry for 2 days and get a fucking job.
Yeah. So go back to, and it's funny. I had to go to my boss who I worked for in the summers before and tell him, because he's like, what? Why the hell are you here? And that was another embarrassment. All of these, every step was I had to tell everyone.
You just
this.
Had to own it everywhere.
Everywhere I went. Yeah. And then I had to stay in school because to keep your health insurance, you had to be a full-time student. So I would take night classes to stay in school at the community college. And then this is winter time. So I was plowing at night, working construction during the day, going to school. At the time I had...
What's plowing at night?
Just snow, moving snow, stuff like that. So it was white gold.
Us West Coast people don't know that stuff.
Yeah, just moving
snow. When I hear plowing at night, I think of something else, but...
Yeah, just moving snow, shoveling snow.
Okay.
Yeah, I wasn't really doing much plowing. I was the guy that got out of the truck to shovel the snow.
Okay.
I had, when I was in school in upstate New York, I got my a personal trainer license, that you can get online for $5 and, you're a trainer.
Uh-huh.
And so I was like, I always knew I wanted to do that. And so I would apply. I was just kept applying to all these gyms around the area. And most places said no, because, who's this guy? No experience.
The usual suspects, 24-hour golds, that kind of?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I got an interview at one place in Connecticut, 45 minutes from my dad's house, and showed up there in my dad's suit, literally. And they all looked at me like, why are you wearing a suit?
He's 5'10". That must have been a lot of
I looked like Richie Rich, wearing his dad's stuff. And but I somehow got this personal trainer gig, and that's where it's my first, time ever training anyone. It's at this gym. So I'm working construction, personal training, and going to school.
Timestamp this. What year is this?
So this would be 2009.
Okay.
Because this is where I found out about CrossFit.
This all explains the Hobart relationship too,
Yeah.
This guy knows intensity, intimacy, hardship, what's real, what's not real, what not to be intimidated by, what to be intimidated by, what not to fear what other people are saying about you, how to have meaningful, honest, true relationships.
Yeah.
As a fucking whole life. He don't give a fuck if he jumps into bed with Hobart.
No.
You know what I mean? He knows who the hell he is. He doesn't give a...
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And his love for his buddy is true because you value stuff.
Yeah. And it's...
And you value trust and honesty and intimacy and hardship, and it's cool. Anyway.
Yeah.
It's cool that just hit me. I was going to write that down. I don't even have to write it down. I already interrupted you and said it.
Nailed it. Yeah, so that was 2009. It was at this gym where, you know, one of the veteran trainers, you know, every gym's got the veteran trainer, the salty dog. And he was like, you got to, you know, we were there and I was, you know, just training and personal training. People was like, you got to try this CrossFit thing. I was like, what?
Oh, say that again. What year was that, did he say?
2009.
Wow.
And I was like, okay. You know, like, you know, sure. I had no idea what it was. And he was like, well, they have this workout called Fran. You know, it's like their...
What kind of computer did you have?
Oh, I think I had a Compaq. Yeah.
Hardcore.
Yeah, with a floppy drive.
All right.
Yeah. And I remember he pulled it up and I did it. So I did, you know, 21:15:9, you know, thrusters and pull-ups. And I remember my 4 minutes and 56 seconds was my time. I don't know if anything actually counted, right?
That's actually pretty damn good.
But, you know, like...
It's incredible.
Yeah, you know, and I just... And I
strict,
threw up.
Strict pull-ups.
Probably. You know, like in the power rack, you know, like right. in the squat rack, yeah. you know. And I remember, you know, I threw up in the garbage can right
What is your reach?
Well, I'm 5'5", and my reach, I think I'm like... My ape index is like negative, like it's 8 or something. So I think I'm like almost like 6, like 8 inches shorter than my height. Oh, like my
then your wingspan.
Then my wingspan.
You have a 68-inch reach.
Whatever it is, it's crazy. Like when I
no no no, it'd be more than that. 65 feet is 60 inches. 65, 73-inch. You have the reach of a man who's 6'1".
Yeah, about so. Yep. Yeah, Hendel. I have about the same reach as Spencer Hendel. Yeah.
Wait, really? When you guys go like this?
Yeah.
You guys are wow, and he's a giant dude. It's not like he has T-Rex arms or anything.
No, he's normal. Yeah, he's got normal anthropometrics.
Okay, sorry. Okay, yeah. I was just imagining you doing Fran in 4:56 and how unfair that is.
Yeah, yeah. it all evens out, you know. And then so I did it, and that's where like, and it blew my mind how hard it was. And then I started digging deep on what this CrossFit thing was, and because I was bored in the gym, I was just a meathead, you know, doing whatever.
What did he say about your time? Was he like,
he had no idea,
dude? Like, you're insane.
He's like, that's good. I think it was like, that's good, you know, like.
But he didn't do it in under 5 minutes.
No, I don't even think he did it. You know, he was like, you got to do it. You know,
perfect. Perfect.
You were the test.
Yeah, he was like, you got to try this thing, but I'm not going to do it.
So in 2009, you're doing your first CrossFit workout. In 2010, you're with Miko Sala, Rich Froning, and Graham Holmberg fucking warring at 7,500 feet in Lake Tahoe.
Well, and that was
amazing.
And it was just funny because then I researched it, and that's when I bought... So every second counts was like on the... So I went to
CrossFit. Amazing movie.
So I bought it, and it got shipped. And I think... Yeah, it's funny because I remember my wife and I were living in different places because, you know, we were my girlfriend, Mara, at the time. And she, every time we'd come over, I'm like, let's watch Every Second Counts on the DVD player. She's like, I don't want to watch it again. I was like, we got to watch it. You know, like, I really like Josh Everett. He's really cool. You know, like, and we'd watch it. And she knows the whole plot more than anyone else because I forced her to watch it. And I bought the games manual. Like, it was like the games book.
Uh-huh.
Of like all the athletes,
yeah.
And I studied their time because I was like, I'm going to compete. Why not? You can compete.
Right.
And I've tracked the 2009 CrossFit Games via like however we were tracking at the time.
Did you watch that entire video we put out on the 2009 Games? I mean, that thing was like 9 hours.
I watched it.
Was extensive.
I mean, here's what to an example of my ridiculous extremism taken into the world of CrossFit. So I bought my level one. I had to open up 2 credit cards to do it because they only give me a $500 limit.
Right.
So I got 2 credit cards, got that. Then I was like, I don't even know what Olympic lifting is. I got to go to one of these courses. So I had to do the same for Coach Bergner's course. Get another credit card. So I had all these credit cards just so I could go to courses, right?
That's amazing.
And then I was like, okay, I gotta learn. And then, there's a CrossFit Journal. So I printed every article at the time that was ever
like
published.
At Kinko's or in your home machine
at the gym and then
cha-ching probably saved
and
50
I,
bucks
I right literally there. It was then I like I had laminated half the book because I was like I gotta save this stuff, you know. That was a mistake because I didn't realize how heavy laminated papers were. It quadrupled the size of the notebook, but I still have it at home, you know. So I read
will
every
you post
article.
A picture of that on Instagram.
I'll find
your
it,
laminated yeah.
Oh, oh yeah, if I hope hopefully it made the move, but I studied the manual of so it would have been the 2000 I think eight of all the stats. Yeah. I was like, in order for me to go to the games, I highlighted everyone's best stat. So like, if who had the best ran time, I had like the data of who was the best at each workout. I was like, I got to beat all these times. It's the only way I can make it to the games, and like, know I can do it.
Is all this other stuff behind you now? Are you on probation?
Well, yeah.
Is it behind you? Is the college fucking with you? Or is that, does it all just kind of like you come home from college and it just, the whole past just dies and just reinvent yourself at a construction job?
Well, not really. No, I mean, like, so like, it's because I still need to get my degree. And like, I was like, you know, like, I've done so much for this. So I knew I had to end up going back up because of my degree in exercise science. You have to do like this big research thing. It's like, so I had to go up there. So I still had to reapply. Hopefully.
Oh.
So this was all this concurrently.
Okay.
So I started training for the CrossFit Games. So I was like, you know, I'm going to go. But then I had to move back up to Syracuse. So I moved up to Syracuse. So I was like.
So you were at the 2009 games?
10.
10. Okay. So, not Aromas. Okay.
Yeah. So this is when I got my level one in Watertown, Connecticut.
And what did you think about the L1?
I loved it. I was so excited for Fran that when I did it there, I hit my chin on the pull-up bar and I didn't want anyone to know. And I definitely gave myself a full-on concussion and it hurt so bad. I finished it in like sub 3 minutes because I was like, I'm gonna show them. Because like at this time, I understand and respect participants that go full out because that was me. Like I was like, I'm going to show them that I can go to the CrossFit Games. Like, because Pat Barber was there.
There was some other footage where you knocked yourself out on a bar I saw one time.
I think that was at King. That was at the Arnold Classic.
It was like a Dirty South bar. Yep. You hit your head, went down, kind of.
Yeah, I'm really good at hitting my head.
Yeah, that was amazing. Yeah. Okay. Were you doing muscle-ups or pull-ups?
Well, when I knocked myself out, it was muscle-ups at the Arnold Classic.
Okay.
Did that, but when I was just, I hit my chin on the pull-up bar coming down. For another rep.
At the L1.
At the level one. And I just remember, like, I definitely, like, because I finished it, and I was so messed up from going as hard as I could and smashing my head. I went outside, I threw up again, like, and didn't want to tell anyone because, you know, it was embarrassing. And I tried to pull it together, but I don't really remember most of the conversations the rest of that evening.
Good thing we weren't testing back then.
Wow.
On day two.
Yeah, right? Yeah, thank God.
And was that life transforming for you, that L1?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I can tell you I just remember I sat three seats into the left. You know, I remember Dennis Marshall deadlifting in his Vibram Five Fingers 405. I was like, this is the strongest person ever. You know, like, awesome. I just remember like-
What's your deadlift today?
570.
That's the strongest person ever.
I don't know about that. But he inspired me. So then, of course, like...
Have you done five, Tyson?
No.
No.
No. Far from it.
Crazy. Crazy, Austin.
So I got Vibram Five Fingers.
Have you ever done steroids?
Have I ever done?
Yeah.
No. No. But I've seen people do them.
You have?
Oh, yeah. College. Fraternity.
Like this or like this?
Well, yeah. I mean, you inject your buddies in the shoulders, the butt.
Can't you do pills? Can't you do like...
Yeah, I mean, you can take what is, you know, you can take, but yeah. I mean,
D-ball
like,
pills?
Yeah, D-ball pills, but you might as well just, if you're going to do the damn thing, do it right.
Okay, yeah. Okay, all right.
But all right. Yeah, that's why like, and that's another
thing. So 570 is clean.
Oh, yeah.
And that's got to be more than double body weight.
Yeah, I'm 175, so
it's coming up on three.
Yeah, yeah coming up on yeah. three, yeah. That's all I got.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Yeah. So your L1's amazing. You remember where you sit. You saw the guy deadlift 405.
It was just like all those moments, you know, bottom squats and the med ball, all that fun stuff. And, you know, I moved back up to Syracuse. So I moved to Syracuse out, which is a half an hour outside of where I went to school because I wanted to make sure I was never in a situation to make a poor decision. So I was like, all right, I'm going to go to college school twice a week, Tuesday, Thursdays, 8 a.m. to, you know, 7 at night. And then I got a personal training job at a gym up there, and that's where I went.
And Marin stays with you through all this?
No, Marin now, at this point, is graduated because now I'm late. So she's now lives in Albany. And
are you guys still together?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, she doesn't take a break from you? She's not like, all right, dude.
She stays with me like a complete boss. And,
that's awesome.
You know, so she's working at State Farm. So she got a job at a school and starts working at State Farm. And, you know, and that's where I actually went to my first CrossFit gym outside of Albany. Because I went to see her, it's like I'm doing, you know, and then I went to CrossFit Saratoga because that's where she lived. You know, I'll never forget this. You pull up the website and I'm like, I'll go here. They have a class at this time. I'm driving to this neighborhood. It's like a really nice neighborhood. I'm like, this is not where gyms are. You know, like this, I'm really stressed out. I'm like, and then like, you know, now I'm in a cul-de-sac. I'm like, okay, something's wrong.
Oh shit, it's someone's house.
Yeah, so like, and then I, so like I pull down, like I park on the other side of the cul-de-sac, and like I'm now I'm like, I see like a garage open. I'm like, I think I hear music. Oh, I see a tire. So then I creep in, like walk down this person's driveway, in a two-car garage, just across the Saratoga. He's a state trooper, and you know, I'll actually recently, you know, saw them at a level one that they re-upped their level one. And, you know, we, for the first
still
time,
at
still at it, still doing it, across the Saratoga.
How cool.
Susan and Susan Douglas, she sort of runs the operation, and then her husband is active military as well. So it was just cool to like see them. And, but that was my first.
So you went in his garage and worked out with
him?
Did
the Filthy 50, yeah.
Were there others there?
It was like, you know, like a neighbor and their kid, you know?
That's
like,
awesome.
So it was all family, basically.
Yeah. That's cool.
You know, where like you do the wall balls into the corner of the 10-foot ceiling, you know? Because that's, yeah. You know, and, you know, there's a hole into the crawl space for your rope climbs. Like, that was the affiliate. So that was my first ever affiliate I was ever in. And then when I went up to Syracuse.
Did they charge you?
I think
like 10 bucks in a jar.
Yeah, it was like, you know, or like, you know, first workout's free or something like, you know,
right.
Something like that. But, you know, I remember like I couldn't do double unders, and I did the filth. I did everything in the Filthy 50, and then I got to double unders, double my time. You know, broke four jump ropes out of frustration.
Oh, that's funny.
Just because, you know.
His jump ropes.
I think they were mine. I had my own jump
rope. So no matter how much you paid,
yeah.
You fucked them.
Yeah, no, I had the Buddy Lee jump rope. So I was like, remember that thing. Just the huge handles.
When do you think, okay, I want to be on the L1 team? And what makes you actually think you can do that? Or did you not really think you could?
So I was coaching. So this is, I started coaching at CrossFit DeWitt up in Syracuse. That's where I start, like really started coaching. And he, it was just funny. Like I would just go there to work out and didn't have a lot of classes. And someone just showed up one day when they didn't have another coach. And I was like, I'll coach.
And you had your L1.
Yeah. And so I started coaching, and that's where I started that organic journey. And then after the games, I was fortunate enough to finish sixth in 2010. And so I kind of figured, I was like, I think
who finished fifth?
I don't know.
Who finished seventh?
I have no idea.
Did you know Spencer at the time?
No, I didn't.
Did you do better than him?
I think so. Yeah. He recently, yeah. Cause that was, I had a better finish between him and I, and then he finished fifth in like 2014 and got me.
Okay.
And then, so
you're training at the gym.
Yeah. Oh yeah. And so I went to the CrossFit games, and I was like, you know what? I think I'm going to shoot Dave an email and ask if I can intern on the seminar staff. Cause maybe I'm on his radar. And I was like, you know, I just finished six. Maybe right. He knows who I am.
Right. Right. You know? Of course he does.
You know, and shot him a note, and I said, I'd love to have the opportunity to intern. And he said, sure. And I interned, the first one was ironically where I took my level one at, There it is.
Look at those names you're with.
Right behind Miko Thielen.
Pat Burke.
Ooh.
Yeah. Pat Burke, the cockroach. Yep.
Wow. Look at those guys.
Yeah.
Peter Edged.
Oh, man.
Fucking Hall of Famer. Tommy Hackenbrook, another one. Yep. Ben Smith, Patrick mm-hmm. Burke. Half those guys are,
hey,
are dead now.
Hey, look at O'Connor.
Eric O'Connor. Look.
Wow.
I beat Hobart that year.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Miko, Matt Chan,
Peter Edged,
Spieler. Awesome. Oh, now I remember. I remember the year because I remember when Spieler made it to the podium. I remember thinking, wow, those workouts, like, I felt like those workouts were really for him that year. I accused Dave of programming for Chris. He didn't like that. He didn't like that at all.
That's awesome.
That's cool.
Okay, so you do your three internships and you're in?
Yeah, so I got
in. Just like that?
Well, I remember I was in, I think I did two internships. I forget how many I did. But I remember Pat Sherwood was like my point of contact, and he gave me like eight pages of feedback. I was like, well, this isn't good.
Wow.
And then at the end, he's like, I'm going to green light you. And I was like, I don't know what that means. Like, what does green light mean? Like, I called
that
everyone.
Must be military stuff.
Yeah, I was like, oh man, like
SEAL shit.
Yeah, I'm like, oh damn. Like, so he's like, but like, you know, you'll get an email from Dave and Nicole, like, you know, because they make the decision. I was like, okay, you know. And I heard nothing. I was like, well, okay, it was a good run, you know?
So Pat Sherwood gave you the green light and eight pages of notes.
Yeah.
And you were like, what the fuck? What's this?
Yeah, I was like, I didn't know. I had no idea. what was going to happen after that, but I didn't, you know, I didn't hear anything. And then we had, you know, this is when we had the invite for the throwdown in Tahoe. So that was after the second internship. And so, you know, we flew out to Tahoe and, you know, Dave was there and the whole crew was there. And I just, we were the first night we were walking from, you know, we had two houses. It was great. You know,
so you get to Tahoe and you've yet to get a response from Dave or Nicole.
Correct. So
I'm over here taking a selfie. Thank you for
yeah
following. That's the first time I've done that in the podcast, by the way. Thank you, Tyson.
Yeah, you're welcome.
So, you know, we're in Tahoe.
Were you starstruck at all? Graham Holmberg, Miko Salo. I mean, they were names at the time.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's, you know, at that time, you're like, it's always, you have that, like, do I belong here? You know, it's like, was this a mistake? You know, like a fluke, you know, like you have that just because a lot of it is, you just don't know.
Oh my God, look at Barber. No wonder I fucking used to call him the Manimal. He really does look like a werewolf.
There I am. That's me. House. Look how little I am.
Yeah. What's going
on at the road? Wow, you are.
Do a little briefing and then dinner. So we're going to learn about, we're going to learn what we're going
to
do.
I hate listening to myself.
We have no idea.
Look how much tanner you are now that you're out of jail.
Yeah. So I was on one of these walks, ironically enough, is where Dave told me I was on staff.
Did you see my motorhome?
It's your own motorhome. I was just going to say that.
Really?
Yeah. So I don't think I have like a formal letter anywhere that's like, hey, welcome to the team. We were just walking and he was like, you know, nice job on your internship. Welcome to the team. And I was like it was like one of those moments where like, I just like, really? Like it was such an amazing, it was like, that was such a big goal and it was unbelievable that it happened. And then, you know, and then out there, it was just funny how like it all was just like happening. You're at this amazing event with these amazing people. And, you know, so it was just ironic how this was where I was told.
Do you remember when Rich called Graham out to do the overhead squat workout?
Oh, there was a lot of tensions. You could cut through with a knife.
That was uncomfortable, right?
Very. Because we all were just like,
because that was that was Graham's, you know, weak link, right?
Yes.
At the time.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Man.
That was real. It showed a champ.
Right.
You know, it's like, hey, I'm going to just, so what a killer does, right? Like,
right.
It's like, I mean, he's a killer.
And
there's a lot of people probably haven't seen this. This might be one of the coolest projects we've ever done.
Oh, man. It's.
People need to go watch this.
This is one of my, we were in that hot tub with Pat Barber. And I never spoke to him beyond my level one where he had the professional cape on and he goes, hey, Austin, you move like shit.
First thing he said in the hot tub?
Yeah. I said, nice to see you again, Pat. It's like, you're strong. You move like crap. So like moments like that just happened because just were happening.
Have you guys reconciled?
Oh yeah. We still laugh about it. It's great.
Do you remember the Dave and Castro and Camille did a jump rope competition right there on that?
Yes. Yeah. The double undercut.
Yeah, on that platform. And look at Rob.
Look at, oh man.
Rob was chaperoning.
So, yeah, they're back there.
And then do you remember the foot race that Miko Salo got in that one workout and how fast he ran?
Oh, forever. And then remember,
he was like shot out of a cannon.
And then the Pat Barber, Chris Spieler thruster
woods
run workout.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Yes.
Matt Chan challenged me to a log throw. Of course. Yeah. Right? Oh, look at that flow.
The flow.
So
we need to rerun this. That was so good.
We need to recreate it.
It's one of the most like asked for things too. Like, oh, like, you gonna do more of that? I'm like, man, because it was such also a unique time of like for CrossFit, for where we were as athletes, as people. Like it was unique.
That was the first that was like right when game sponsorship really kind of came on the scene.
Yeah. Oh man, it was just.
Will we see you back at the games, as an individual athlete?
Not this year. I think we're scheming for another team.
Okay, so what? You didn't qualify the year before.
No, I missed that. Yeah.
So is the window closed? Tell me about aging. Is aging?
Yeah. I mean,
talk to Josh and Dan like you're pretend like I'm Josh and Dan and talk to them what you know about aging.
Yeah, it's not that you're getting, it's time under tension and injuries.
Okay.
You know, so like the year prior, like, you know, I tore a ligament in my wrist a week before regionals.
Okay.
You know, like that just stuff wasn't happening 5 years ago. you could train full on and do the, you know, whatever it is and be ready for it. Like things like that happen. And it's like,
that literally like a time under tension thing, or is it just that training has changed?
I think it's both, where it's like, you know, I'm 30 years old, and I think the year 30 matters a lot less, that I've been doing this for, training with volume for 9 years. And then the past 5 years, the volume, has doubled what you did, right? The predicated five.
Totally, right.
And, so with that, it's a math game.
With minimal fitness gains too, right? Like if we're talking to the average person, like 3 on, 1 off, and you can still be fucking in the 99 percentile.
Correct.
But if you want to start.
Yeah, if you really want to start to pursue this notion of competing, what you have to do throughout a day is just, it's so much more practice, but practice is relative to your ability. So the loading's going to be a little higher, right? So, when you practice, cycling a barbell, that barbell needs to have 135 pounds on it. For your members, it's a PVC pipe, right? There's just a difference what practice means, and that does take a toll on the body.
Right.
And you talk, anyone in that video is a good example that's still competing. Everyone's still, what people
Matt Frazier was here last week, and he said that like it's not very far from, he's not very far off,
yeah,
from basically being in like lockdown games training mode where it becomes an 8 hour a day.
Yeah.
No travel, nothing.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So that's what you're talking about. It's the difference between going in, hitting it for an hour,
right,
or spending literally all day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's what people don't like to talk about is that it's painful. It's a professional sport. I mean, every competitor at the top, or that's trying to be at the top, trying to break into the top or stay in the top, is in pain all day. That is no different in any sport at the apex. Right. And that's what people don't like to talk about. It's because it's different. It's a sport. Your goal is not fitness or health. Your goal is to win. And when your goal is to win, you're going to sacrifice everything to achieve that goal.
Sure.
And that's sort of like where, and at any point, it's in certainly our sport specifically, it's a high impact sport where there's no non-high impact positions, right? It's like certain leagues, right? You see like quarterbacks can last a long time.
Everybody snatches. Everybody
that's right.
catches heavy cleans.
That's right. And also I think, part of it too is I just look at it where like the quality of movement, size of the athlete really matter, for longevity. We see really good athletes go to the CrossFit Games for 1 year and never come back. Watch their movement. I guarantee you they don't move well.
Well, what about, right. what about on the other end of that, you have someone like Sam Briggs.
Mm-hmm. How many times has she been injured?
Right. But she's actually improved significantly, but yeah. She was one of the best. She was one of the worst movers I had ever seen at the CrossFit Games. She may even get that title.
There's a quote.
Now she's a great mover, but she's been around a long, right. Or I don't know if a great mover, but she's better than most people.
In order for her to have stayed in the sport to succeed, she's had to become a better mover, but like, look at what's held her
back.
And
she's not just succeeding. She's dominating, right?
I mean, she is a genetic freak. She what she can do is unbelievable. If she started to move that well 10 years ago,
okay,
like that's the thing where like you look at, I utilize Rich as an example. Rich has always moved really well, and also has some unbelievable. He's just a freak as well. But like, and you combine that, Matt Frazier moves well.
Yeah, Greg's actually said that for years.
Yep.
He said, you look, there's a direct correlation between games finishing standing and quality of movement.
Yes. And I think it's the consistency piece because, and this is where people get wrapped around the axle, even down the affiliate level.
Tia, by the way, just throwing there, amazing.
Yeah. Yes.
Amazing mover.
Technician.
Even her burpees look different than other people's burpees. I mean, she flows, not only just in the technical moves, but she's flowing. Yep. She's like in water.
Yeah.
It's not about a task accomplishment across a single task in a single day. It's task accomplishment across years of training.
My audio is doing some weird shit, like switching back and forth between head.
I've been getting that as well.
I've been getting that too.
Okay. All right.
I just feel like it's like,
God, wouldn't it be a shame if we have to do this whole thing again?
It's going back and forth.
Okay. Go on. Sorry.
Yeah. It's just that. So I think that's another thing of the quality of movement. And that's why you have to, when you see perennial games athletes, and I utilize James as an example. James is one of the best movers that we ever see, which allows him to be doing, to have done this for now 10 years, and he's getting fitter and stronger still. Right. So you see that sort of stuff, and that
So you're done.
As an individual?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Okay.
But
the keeping the hope alive.
Oh yeah, I mean, I love the team thing. It's just so different.
Let me lay this equation for you out. This algebraic equation. Mm. You have Austin Mariola, who, let's say, in his prime, did not win the games.
Correct.
But he goes to the games to win the games, mm-hmm. and he's had an incredibly successful games career. Just by going five times as an individual is mm-hmm. must put you in some sort of small group.
Six.
That six, including team. All right, I said individual. Yep. So you've even mentioned that you're thinking about maybe having kids in your future. You have a lot of different things going on in your life, and now you're not going to go to the games this year as an individual because you have a team that you think you want to rock with. So now we're talking, you're going to be 33 years old.
Yeah,
and we've already established that. What your career has been like up until this point.
Yeah.
And it could be argued that your career is waning because you didn't make it the last time you tried to go as an individual. Mm-hmm. But you would have to put in, now here comes the cherry on top, mm-hmm. you'd have to put in 8 hours a day for 9 months mm-hmm. knowing that the last time you went to the regional is you didn't even make your goal.
Right.
Does that seem
insurmountable?
Not insurmountable. Does that seem smart? Like, what would be the point if the goal is to go to the games?
Right.
Does it seem like a good use of your time? And how do you reconcile all that that blender of shit I threw at you? That equation.
Does it seem like a good use of your time? Absolutely not. you know. So, is it? It's more of a mindset of, I've never known CrossFit without competing. I found CrossFit and I was like, I'm going to compete, and I somehow made it in 2010. Ever since then, it's make it to the games or fail at making it to the games, and that's been it. And then
whereas for me, being in the open is a huge success. It really is. Like when I pay and I finish the open, I'm like, holy shit, I did it.
Yeah,
and we're in two totally different places.
And for some people, like they start doing CrossFit and then they're like, they somehow fall into the world of competing. And somehow, they go to compete. Like it's like a progression.
Right.
Where for me it was like, I'm gonna do CrossFit to compete.
Right.
I found out about coaching and this life improvement part of CrossFit secondary.
Okay.
Where it's usually the other way around for a good amount of people. Now it's changing, right? Because now the sport has grown to be its own sport, which is amazing. Now, I think that if you would ask me realistically, do you think that I'm gonna go individual again? Probably not. Do I rule it out? No. But I love training. And I love competing, and that's what keeps it going. When it's not fun, when it's no longer love, like I'll have that discussion. But I hear a lot of people that don't love to train; they just do it because they want to win, they want to compete.
Yeah.
I love to train. You know, competition is stressful.
And the videos show that too, by the way. Some of the road trip stuff I've seen, like with you and Hobart, or the videos with you and Hendel, it's clear that you're the guy in the room having the most fun.
Yeah, it's. So I'm like, well, what? I'm just going to keep it going,
right.
I'm going to keep going. And that's,
you're going to show up to the party every day.
Yeah. And let's train, let's do it. Like, you want to wake up at 5 and train? Cool. Yes. You know, like I'll do whatever you want, you know? And I think that's something that, so when that changes, I'll reevaluate. I learned a lot about myself as a competitor and a human being on team this year. So I'm not done there. I still think there's more growth. That's why I'm a pretty strong advocate for a team. I learned more as an athlete and a leader and a teammate this year than I did in my 6-7 years of competing as an individual in 1 year.
Can you give me something?
When you're an individual, you have to be and you should be selfish with your training. When you're on a team, you cannot be. And that was a really difficult switch for me. It was that I have to care about 5 other people as much, if not more, than I care about myself.
You mean working on their weaknesses when they're not yours?
That's almost at the least. It's more or less what you say, how you say it, how you react to a workout. You know, if I say to someone, hey, that workout was easy, but it was someone's hardest workout, I just offended them.
Right.
Right. And then for me, it's like, oh, get over it.
Right.
As opposed to like, I shouldn't say that next time because they're on my team and my success is tied to their success.
Right.
And vice versa. And
so it's some hardcore empathy.
Yeah.
And social awareness.
Denise Thomas was your guys' coach.
Yeah.
Was this a handful for her? Like, is this something she was? Well,
we called her in because we were like, man, like we need someone to corral us and tell us what to do because it wasn't working with just like me telling everyone what to do and things like that. Our team needed someone outside of me or someone else telling them what to do. And I think that's so she came in. It was great because she's a unbelievably detail oriented and unbelievably empathetic. And that was really good for us.
I was going to say, what a great person to pull into that.
Yeah. You know, and
who is on the team?
So it was myself, Spencer Hendel and Connor Murphy.
Mm-hmm.
And then Rachel Martinez, Allison Bushy Leard, and then Kate Brierley.
Okay.
Yeah. So
stacked.
Yeah, it was a fun team. It was cool because
stacked a group of people.
Yeah, it was fun. We had some crazy circumstances during the open. Rachel dislocated her elbow, full dislocation during the snatch workout. We were like,
meaning
all the way out, bam, out to the side. It was like, and the X-ray looked like this.
Wow.
It was the grossest thing I've ever seen.
Wow.
So like, you know, we had that, you know, and then you know,
did Connor tweak his neck?
Connor broke his neck after regionals.
Yeah.
So we had
working out or in a car accident or
from the, you know, after like from the worm. Yeah. It's it. So that was crazy. So like just, and you know, I just remember like, I would just drive home from the gym and I'm like, our season's over. I remember like when Rachel blew her elbow, I'm like, we're done. Like we're not going to make regionals. Cause how are we going to finish?
Right.
You know, Denise is the unsung hero because we didn't have any alternates except her. Because
so your coach trained with you?
Her final two scores were submitted for our women because she was the only.
Because Rachel was out.
Rachel couldn't do, you know, she could only, you know, she couldn't really do it because of her arm.
Did she end up being on the demo team?
No, Rachel was on our team. She competed at the games and regionals.
Oh damn!
So she recovered. She was like Wolverine. I don't know how she's like made of adamantium. She recovered for the.
Oh, you know who I'm confusing her with? Fuck! I always do that. What's Rachel's last name?
Martinez.
I'm confusing her with Kelly Jackson.
Right. Oh. They look very similar.
Who's here?
Okay. Yeah, she'll be here.
Okay. Okay. Like in a few minutes. Sorry. And Kelly Jackson was on the demo team.
Correct.
Sorry. Got it.
So, like, just having moments like that where, like, I just remember calling Spencer. I was like, Spencer, like, I was like emotional. I was like, I didn't see it ending this way, this year. You know, like, and you have those moments where, like, when you're an individual, it's all you. There's sanctuary and there's also, you know, obviously responsibility with that. But man, with the team, it is so different. And I think that if you are an athlete and you really want to become a better athlete or a better person at some point, and you're in an individual sport, do a team at some point.
What place did you guys take?
Fifth.
Can you win it with your new team?
Yes. But I can't release who's on the team yet.
Okay.
Because, like, of, like by
you're on it.
Yes.
How many spots are up for grabs?
Spencer's on it.
Yeah.
So he's like, I can't. We're just gonna go process of elimination here.
Yeah. Is Connor on it?
Maybe he's still battling. Like, so he's.
Is Rich Froning on it?
No. Rich is not.
Is Hobart on it?
Maybe.
Okay. That would be really weird if Hobart got on your team.
Hey,
that'd be really.
That
cool.
That would be really smart for you guys because people don't know this. James is like. He's won.
He's good.
He's the most decorated. He's the most decorated team. He's the most decorated team athlete in history.
In CrossFit Games history. And people don't know that about him.
He's also.
Because he won with New England.
Oh.
And then Mayhem.
Twice.
Yeah.
So he's
the good luck charm. You guys.
Yeah, he's the good luck charm. Wow.
He's also a very, very good team leader. So like, you know, like what people don't realize that like he, so him and I are very different. I'm like I'm very abrasive when it comes to like just interaction and feedback when it comes to just anything like when and like hey like that's not good, we got to change this. He's like very soft and approachable and people love him in that setting.
Yeah, I work with him now and he is no matter how abrasive I am, he just kind of absorbs it the way like a rock goes into a marshmallow.
Right.
He's just like
right. It's like
he's smooth.
Yeah, he's not like I'm like sandpaper. You know, like I'm hopefully useful, but sometimes abrasive, you know, needs to be used correctly with the right, you know, grit.
You exfoliate where James.
Yeah. He's the
lubricates.
Yeah.
He's the moisturizer.
Yes. That's right. Yes.
That's right. He's the moisturizer to the ped egg. But yeah, so I mean, so he, you know, so and then, you know, and we'll probably have all new women because of our, you know, just of where they're at. Rachel's like rehabbing.
Give us some names on the women. What kind of, like, what kind of women are we talking about?
You know, so we have a few people up for grabs. I mean, there's James' girlfriend, who is
wife or girlfriend?
Their girlfriend, unless they eloped last night.
Hey, from what I hear, their relationship is like, there's just gonna be a lot of talking and no training.
Well, there'll be a lot of making out, that's for sure.
Oh, good. Make us they all do that? Do they do PDA?
Yeah, stresses me out because I don't like PDA.
I like it, but I grew up with my mom like saying it wasn't cool, but yeah. I like it.
Yeah, I'm just. Yeah, they do their thing, but she's really fit, like, and she works. She's like one of those like has a real job, like, and what I mean by real job, like, has to commute to the city,
right.
Come back, but she crushes
somehow
it, like,
still
5 a.m. Yeah, like finds the time and like does great. And then, you know, there's a few other studs around the area. There's Ashley Wozni, who won the teen championship, I think 2 years ago.
That'd be cool.
So she trains at Spencer's gym, but she, you know, she's now, you know, coaching and looking for, you know, coaching and stuff like that. And then we have a few other people that like right on the cusp of regional, like just missing regionals. So
so you're not pulling anyone out of the games?
No,
like a 16th place from
no,
the game.
It's you know, it's funny where I've had those, you know, we've had that, you know, people come in and train. Like, what means a little more to me is like, because part of it's like, if you're gonna, like, you have to like be a part of the community and coach at the gym. Like, I like the whole super team. I get it. But like, you know, like Spencer coached at Reebok CrossFit One for years before he opened up his gym. And, you know, so like things like that were like, I want to tie to the community and tie to the people as much as having a great team. And I think you can do both. And, you know, we're fortunate enough to have we're lucky to have unbelievable athletes in the surrounding area.
I mean, Mayhem did it, right? That was no super team that they were under the radar, right?
I mean, you know,
I mean, look at Ute's team this year.
Yeah,
you know, it was kind of a mixed bag.
You would say that Mayhem's was a super team. You were given like a.
Yeah, you have Lindy. You know who's, you know, but what I think.
But
what,
she's a wounded duck, right? I mean, at any moment she could be like, "Hey, my back's out. I can't go on." She's a high risk,
high reward.
And then you
she
have
seems the, to manage that so well.
Yeah, I mean, you wouldn't even know unless
even
you know.
That that's
right,
like
right, right, right. Yeah. And then you have, well, I mean, she talks about it.
Yeah.
And then the what's the blonde girl that they're always scaring?
Ellie.
Yeah.
She's awesome.
Right.
I mean, didn't they build her from the ground up?
And ref it too. You know, but I think that's something that what people don't understand about Rich or environment is that, like,
or they had the 40-year-old lady on the team
when,
the first year they
yeah,
won.
With James, that's, I was
yeah,
unbelievable.
She was amazing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that.
What was her name again? How do I forget her name?
I forget her name. James will know.
Okay.
I'll be on the next one.
But
I've hung out with her a bunch. She's fantastic.
So, and I think with that, it's like, you know, I think a testament to what Rich has done at Mayhem is that, like, they're all there. Like, you know, I think like Lindy's like moving there fully. Like, you know, she's like, it's like, it's cool to see that where, like, you know, people may come down, but then they fully like assimilate to that culture and that lifestyle.
Did you hear Matt Frazier's moving to Cookeville?
I did.
Do you find that against all odds?
You know, I think that if, you know, you, it's a nice place to live.
I can't wait to see how this plays out. Are you excited to see how it plays out?
I bet you I could script it. You know, but
there's gonna be a tradition of winning for a long time out of Cookeville, Tennessee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any chance that we would see what do you think is more likely? Rich gets a third kid or comes back and goes head to head with Matt?
Rich gets a third kid.
Third kid, me. That's what I think too.
Yeah. Yeah, I think
he's about them being on the same team together?
I think you'll see a third kid before that.
Right.
Yeah.
And maybe a fourth kid.
Yeah.
But then maybe on the same team. I mean, Matt acts like when he's done, he's done.
Yeah.
But people say all sorts of silly things in their 20s.
And do all sorts of silly things.
I think we can stop here and we can have you back on.
Cool.
We don't want to like squeeze you every last drop. We'll pick up when you come back on how you became Flowmaster.
Sounds like a plan.
All right.
Cool.
That was awesome.
Will you, we're going to do another podcast here with Hobart. Would you mind co-hosting with Tyson? And
It would be an honor.
All right. Oh, sweet.
That would be good.
Be an honor.
That'd be good.